Hello, I'm Carl Seidel, host of The People's View. The People's View is a show sponsored by the Nashua Republican City Committee. The committee meets every second Thursday at the Crown Plaza. And if you want to contact us, we have a website, nashuagop.org. And at the end of the show, you'll see some contact phone numbers or email addresses that you may want to send us your comments and recommendations. Thank you for listening in.
Welcome to The People's View, a program dedicated to discussing local, state, and national issues and their effect on the American people. The People's View provides a platform for state representatives and national figures to present their viewpoint. Whether it's social, economic, or financial topics, you'll hear it on The People's View.
Our guest today is Sandra Zeem. Sandra, who is a member of the Board of Education, or the school board, as some people call it, and also Commissioner of Hillsborough County. I don't know how you keep them both straight, but that's enough to keep you out of trouble, I guess.
Some people might suggest that I don't keep it straight, but I try.
Well, I'd like to hear a little bit about the school board, because I've been reading in the paper that you've been voted. You had a vote on whether to delay these tests that are sort of a trial test for the Common
Core. It's a smarter balanced, it is the test that comes with Common Core. Mm-hmm. So it's really a part of Common Core. And the question that I think has not been answered, although we did get a legal opinion from Steve Bennett, who is the attorney for the city of Nashua. Mm-hmm. And to do justice, he did a great job. He actually, it was very professionally done, and he cited the RSAs and 6 pages. So he spent.
Yes, he did.
It was a worthy document, and certainly the exciting part for me is that it identifies in it where we lose local control. I think that the worst thing about, at least one of the worst, there's so many things that I don't agree with, mm-hmm. but the worst thing, in my view, is that it circumvents the voter. We, locally, the school board is the elected official that the people put us there to represent their views.
Right.
And if you think about it, they have more influence with us, because we know if we alienate enough of them, we're not going to be reelected. So it is their control, mm-hmm, to some, mm-hmm, extent, mm-hmm, of their children's future. So to take that vote and have an appointed board, which is what happened. What actually happened is the New Hampshire School Board Association, New Hampshire School Board, which is appointed by the governor, mm-hmm, they actually told us that we have to do smarter balanced assessment testing. And it was in the National Telegraph. A lot of people probably saw it maybe a month ago. Mm-hmm. Tom Raffio, who is the chairman of that board, made the statement that we had to take that test, because if we did not, we would lose federal funding. And that's another one of my
Well, how did that roll? Does that get tied with Common Core by itself, or elements of Common Core? Is it
no,
one
it
package?
No, it is the test. It is
I know
the
it's
test,
a test
that
but
you
it's
have to take following Common Core.
Understood.
It
but
replaces
is that
NECA.
Part of the overall support, financial support that the federal government gives you, or is it an element of the financial support?
Well, I was going to say to you, Nashua.
Right.
Has not gotten any Common Core dollars, okay, that I know of, not dollar number one. If, mm-hmm, we've gotten it, it's been under the radar for me, and I've been watching Common Core pretty close.
Well, I mean, with the budget coming up and everything like that, you can't afford to be doing something for nothing.
And one of the sad things is that the argument you get when you say it's an unfunded mandate, and I believe with, mm-hmm, all my heart it is, the argument you get is, well, that's what we'd have to have done that anyway. For instance, the most expensive part of it is that this smarter balanced assessment testing has to be done on computer. Well, we have a little less than 13,000 kids in New Hampshire, mm-hmm, Nashua. And so that being the case, we have to have enough technology to test that many,
right,
that many students on a computer. And that in and of itself is an unfunded mandate because a lot of our technology is obsolete. We do not, for instance, my grandson goes to Windham. And in Windham, they are given a laptop when they go into the ninth grade, and they keep it until the 12th grade. Now, if they break it or misuse it, lose it, they have to pay for it. But barring that, if they take care of it, they have a laptop computer that they can take home for all 4 years. Mm. We, in order in Nashua, in order for us to give these tests, we're putting these tests on carts. 20 on a cart, if you will. We roll the cart into the room, and then we set them up. So it's not like we have the technology. We do not. And so, but when you make that argument, they invariably will say to you, oh, well, we'd have to have done that anyway. Well, you know, I don't agree with that argument, because while I do think technology is a wonderful thing and we need to incorporate it, and the kids, it's a good thing for the kids. But I think that when you look at spending money, you look at the whole, and you say, where are our most critical needs? Where are the things that we just cannot do without? And I'm not sure that computers is one of them. When mm-hmm. I put, for instance, our sixth graders, they tested out on the kneecaps, 85% failure in science.
Wow.
85%, not 60 or 50, 85. So we have 15% of our sixth graders who are passing science. I would suggest to you that some of the money we're putting in technology for this test, we could put into science and get those kids to. I just think one size does not fit all, and mm-hmm. Nashua is the exception because of the diversity we have. Nashua has, I've said this 100 times, but for the public who may not have heard me say it or may not heard anybody mm-hmm. say it, we have approximately 2,000 special education kids. We have 1,000 second language kids with 53 languages. We have in Nashua 53 different languages that are spoken. This year, you know, we got the refugees. I think we got 17 kids that were refugees. Our homelessness went up to 174. It was 150 when I first heard the figure. It is now 174 kids who are homeless. That means that in the morning when they come to school, they may be sleeping in a tent. And so they didn't get to take a shower.
Yeah.
And do you do homework in a tent with no lights? I don't think so. So how do you place priorities without taking that into mm-hmm. consideration? Common Core does not take any of that into consideration. And I think that's a
fault in the whole system.
It's a sin.
Well, not only is it a sin, I mean, they're actually selling it under misrepresentation.
From
the beginning, you had supposedly had the option of turning it down. Now, some people have turned it down. There's several states that have. But are they hurting for money? I don't know. Have you had any feedback from, like, Indiana or Oklahoma?
Well, if you go to different states, you hear different stories. But I think across the country, you're hearing more and more rumbles because
right.
as it's beginning to be incorporated into the everyday practices, then you see the fallacies. And one of the things that I said this week is, how many practice tests do you have to give in order to know what the weaknesses are and to shore them up? Do you have to have one in every state? I don't think so. Mm. A fifth grader is a fifth grader. I think this idea that what they're really doing is they're teaching them how to take the test. They are and the biggest problem that they've had is that the kids don't know how to work on a computer. You have to be able to type to use the computer. And a third grader, Carl, Do you see too many third graders who type fluently enough to type sentences? I mean, they haven't even learned to write yet. I just think it's ludicrous. It's crazy. I think that we were not included in the conversation. Transparent? What was transparent about? Talk about transparency.
Yeah.
Talk about lack of it. And where was the local community dialogue when the New Hampshire School Board, you know, when the appointed officials for the New Hampshire School Board, who are appointed by the governor, do you remember any dialogue where they came down to the district and said, how do you feel about this test?
Well, I remember the other way, where you have a whole school that took it last year, And what happened? They wrote up a whole complaint about
it. That was fair grounds. Right. And the interesting part about that is we just did the field test because I made a motion that we delay that test for 2 years. That motion failed.
Right.
It failed 4-5, so it was close. The vote, the swing vote, if you will, Mrs. Muse, her thinking, she was concerned about a lawsuit. She was concerned that if indeed the state has the authority to tell local what to do, and Mr. Bennett's legal opinion supported that, then she did not want to get the city, into a lawsuit with state. Having said that, if you succumb to every puff of wind, if when something comes along that's being forced on you, that you feel, you sincerely feel, is not best for your kids, then do you just go along with it to avoid a fight? And if you do that, where will it ultimately lead you? What is the risk of not speaking up when things aren't what they should be? The risk is that it will get worse and worse and hurt our children more and more. And in my view, that's what has happened. In my view, this, every time we get a new president, we get a new fix-it. We get a new miracle program, and we're going to, overnight, all these kids are going to be A students, and we're going to compete with all of the countries that do so well. I don't think it happens that way. And that's another one of my big things with Common Core. If you're going to increase scores, in my view, there's one way to do it. You improve classroom. You improve their learning environment. You do not have 29 kids in one classroom with one teacher and no paraprofessional, 7 intensive need students who are on their own special educational plan, 40% who are poverty, 2 or 3 who don't speak English, and this one poor teacher trying
satisfy
to
all those needs.
And I tell you, I recently had a teacher who has just that exact scenario, because this came from him. I tell you that honestly. And he said to me, Sandra, I cannot. I give it everything I have. I give it my last drop of blood. He was very earnest, and he certainly convinced me. And he said, I just cannot. I'm helping one, and the other one is waiting. And he said, so you just cannot do that. I wish I could. I wish I could walk on water, don't you? But I mean, and yet, when we lose good teachers, we don't understand why. The worst thing in the world is to be in a job that you can never do what you wanted.
You can't succeed.
You cannot succeed. Right. There is the worst thing in the world, because what does it do to your self-confidence?
Oh,
you say, what kind of a teacher am I? I can't meet the needs of these kids. I'm sending them home.
Well, why don't I go to another district that doesn't have these problems?
Yes, another school. Why don't I go? And I probably shouldn't say it this way, but why don't I go to a Windham or a Hollis where the tax base is a little bit more fluid and they have smaller classrooms, more paraprofessionals, more reading specialists, more everything.
They don't have all the problems with the children who...
They don't have as many English language learners. Right. They don't have as many special education.
Homeless.
They don't have homeless. They don't have this 43%. Our poverty rate went up too, by the way. We used to cite 40 to 42. Now it's 43. Of course, the economy that we're in
Is a problem also.
Big part of it.
Yeah, I think you hit it on the head that you're faced with a problem of so much diversity, and the way you try to commingle everybody doesn't work for teaching. You're
going
to have to somehow separate some of those problems out so that they can be dedicated in the solution, aren't you?
And at Fairgrounds, it's interesting because Fairgrounds is the one school that was designated this year in need of help by the federal government. So they're getting extra funds to try to increase their learning. And in correlation with that, we had a workshop last week where they came and presented to the school board their plan to increase learning. It was so encouraging. I just couldn't even tell you. We have a new young principal over there, very eager and professional and all the things that you want to see in leadership. But what was even more exciting and more wonderful about it was they had all kinds of innovative new ideas. But this presentation didn't just come from leadership. They had a kindergarten teacher who presented. They had a fifth grade teacher.
Good
for them. And so we heard from everybody. And they're going to do more like that from in the third, I think third, fourth grades, they're going to be breaking up the teaching so that it's almost like high school where the teachers specialize. So you'll have one teacher who teaches English and math and another teacher who teaches science and social studies, if you will. So you're with one teacher in the morning and another teacher in the afternoon. The good thing about that is that those teachers are specializing, so they don't have to have as many lesson plans. They can zero in and make that lesson plan stronger, better. It was really, and then in the summer, just so many exciting things. In the summer, they're going to have, for those kids who have gotten to these older grades and are not reading on level, they're going to have a summer school for them where they can come. Now, it's only starting out with 10, and I tell you honestly, 10 is not enough because we have so many of our kids who get to third grade and cannot. It's just, well, I've told you before, when our kids graduate, it's 40% of them go out the door without reading on grade level. Mm-hmm. And of those, when the English teachers came from the high school and spoke to us, they're going to do an enrichment block as part of this Common Core. And it's one of the things that to some extent I agree with. I disagree, though, in that I think we should start by doing just remedial. Not, they're going to open it up to the whole school and make it like a study hall. Mm-hmm. So if you need help in band, you can go to your band class. If you need help in math, you go to math, or you go to wherever you feel you need that remedial help. My concern is that too much too soon. We need to take baby steps, do one thing and do it well, and then go to the
tweak
next
that
thing.
If you need to.
When you get that perfect, then you go to the, and that's why this every state in the United States is going to be field tested. See, that again makes no sense to me. Why would we put it so grandiose before we've even tested it? And why would we, and I have absolutely gotten to the point where I do not think Common Core was vetted. I do not believe it was vetted. I don't believe that enough people, who is best to tell us what mistakes we're making? Mm-hmm. I would suggest we need to be working. I think you said this at one of our discussions. Mm-hmm. We need to be talking with the community colleges.
Right.
We need to be talking
Definitely.
With those people
who are
know
going to receive these people.
Who are going to have to bring them up to right. where they can even take a college class. I have high school teachers at North and South who say to me on a continuing basis, how do I teach a child geometry or algebra who can't read?
Yeah.
They can't even read the question out of the book. How do you do that?
That's pathetic.
It's sad.
I mean, yeah.
It's very sad. And so my thing is, I admit I'm a maverick, have my own thinking, but for me, the way we should start, the problem is this remedial. It's foundation and those two lower, we level in our high schools. We have four levels. The two are the basic beginnings. That's where we should start with the remedial.
Yeah, definitely.
And because of discipline, starting with everybody, the discipline end of it is mm-hmm. going to be mm-hmm. a nightmare because...
And you have to have reading at grade level to graduate.
But they don't. They let them go through without it.
I know. That's where you have to change
it. It's wrong.
Have a rule, how can you make people try to learn?
To be honest with you, we seem to bend our rules. It depends on how loud you talk. If you come in screaming and hollering, they'll give you they'll give you anything you want just to get you out of their face, I guess. That's like lawsuits. We seem to run in fear of lawsuits.
Yeah.
I think that's the craziest thing. I think at some point in time, you have to stand up for what you believe
you
in. And if that means you have to fight. And I said when they voted against...
Well, you ought to have a meeting with the 27 representatives that you have here in Nashua and say, look, this is our problem. Are you going to introduce legislation to relieve us of this problem?
I did go. I will tell you honestly.
Because I'm sure you can get some people from Manchester, too, feel the same way.
It's funny. It's funny. I did go. I actually went to a legislative meeting where Dr. Murataki has introduced several bills to mm-hmm. try to... He introduced one to postpone smarter balanced assessment
right.
testing. They've all failed. I went to testify, and I was prepared. I went early. I was the first person there. My name should have been the first one on the book because I tell you, I was there a half hour early. I'm always early. That's That's an idiosyncrasy of age. But anyway, and yet they had all of the state reps were first given an opportunity. After the state reps, they let all of the department heads, all of the, so Tom Raffio, Bill Duncan, all of those people who have titles in at state education were allowed to speak. Then they allowed lobbyists to speak. And then she said, I'm sorry, but the time's up. You folks have to go home now.
They're supposed to just ask for a recess to reschedule the next meeting. They're supposed to be able to do that.
It was definitely wired against me. And what blew my mind was it was advertised as a public hearing.
Yeah.
When there was no public. Mm-hmm. So how can you call it? It's like this transparency of Common Core. How can you call
The chair is in charge of that. That's very arbitrary. And there should be, we should have some people on it. Dr. Muritaki should have objected to that, to the chair.
Well, he had left. Uh-huh. It was his bill. It was his bill. He was the first person to present. And after he presented, he had another committee meeting to go to. But I tell you, I was very disheartened. Mm-hmm. Disheartened in that I feel it was a misuse of our system. And
definitely.
I came home and I sent an email to every state rep in the state.
Good.
I sent my email to everybody I could, to all the newspapers. I sent it to the union leader. I sent it to every newspaper in the state, got my email. And basically I said, this is a
farce.
It's a misuse to call this a public hearing and not have one member of the public allowed to speak is an insult to our mm-hmm. system. And it's an insult to every American. And it's not party. It's an insult to every American, whether they're when you violate those rules, you hurt everybody. That's not about party then to me. To me, that is about right and wrong. That's about the basic concepts that made our nation great. So I was disheartened. But I tell myself, keep trucking.
Good. We need more people like you on that. I mean, that's they're essentially ignoring the public's remark. They demonize them by saying, oh, they don't want anything new. They don't want standards. Well, it's not a question of standards. We all want good standards. But we want to have input on what those standards are.
This year, and this is one thing about this Common Core that I would very much like for the public to understand. Why I think it's the biggest reason, there are many reasons I think it hurts the children. But the biggest reason is that, again, we already have 40% of our kids who are below grade level, at least 40. If you raise the bar, if you raise that grade level, if grade level was 40 and now it's 50, that 40% who are below is going to be increased. So I believe that makes our below grade level 50%. 50% of our students are going to be going in, being required to know more without any increased learning to support that.
Have the tools. They're,
right. This year, our budget, the mayor came in and gave us our budget. We were not able to keep it under that budget. She just came back and wants us to cut another $160,000. That being said, we lost 16 teachers this year. Mm-hmm. Not just teachers, social workers, guidance counselors, across the bar. We've cut. So they're not going to get increased learning. They're going to get decreased. There's no way you can decrease mm-hmm. your staff and not have it affect the quality that you are giving. So to force us to raise the bar at a time when we are lowering our ability to reach every child, when in effect we're already not reaching anywhere near all of them, there is no common sense. Mm-hmm. It defies reason.
Well, maybe our listeners should be hearing this and can say something to the superintendent, can say something to the mayor and the aldermen. I mean, this is the way that has to go through, right? It's in the aldermanic budget review committee.
And yes, and that's June 2nd. They're mm-hmm. going to be hearing our budget, and the budget is again, they're asking, the mayor brought our budget back again and said she got money, we took money out of, we have accounts that we, there's a capital, when you have improvements, we have a capital improvements account. And that's basically to do things at the school, like if it needs to be painted or it needs carpeting or it needs maintenance, but on a more substantive level than cleaning. Well, basically, we're going to take money out of that account so that if we have something come up, there'll be no money there for it. And we've just about stripped every account we have that way. So the money's, we are, and again, as I told you before we started talking, Dr. Morataki last night at the school board meeting said that we have $150 million deficit based on the Medicaid expansion that we're doing. So where is all this money going to come from? Are we cutting back based on the fact that we don't have money? Or do we, I mean, they're going to do a chimney, $700,000.
Well, you know, I was going to bring that up. They claim it's coming out of another fund that only has to be used for things like that. Well, so what? Don't spend it, though. I saw the other thing that they're doing in the Broad Street School. They cut down all those trees there. Was that necessary right now? You could do it 2 years from now without any problem.
It's interesting what they're going to do at Broad Street. Uh-huh. Some of the stuff, they're going to make the parking and the drive much more accessible. They're good things.
Absolutely, nice and good things.
Was it the right time?
I'd rather see more remedial training for your reading.
See, when you put more value in cosmetics, when you put more value in surface than you put in people power, if you will, I think it's a bad choice. And that was the mayor, when she came, she said to me, well, we basically disagree. I think infrastructure is important too. And I didn't want to prolong our disagreement, but because she has a right to her opinion. Yeah.
Have to be able to make a story.
My thing is, if yes, we have to have infrastructure, but do we have to have Cadillac sidewalks?
Right.
Do we have to rip out all the trees and all the flowers and put all new? Or could we just fix the bricks that were broken and maintain it until we're in a better financial position? In my budget, when I get behind, then I stop the frills.
Yeah.
And I say, next year, maybe I'll get a new dress. But this year, I'm going to pay the water bill. And so I think that we've lost sight that we cannot have it all. We are, and what we're doing is we're passing it on to the generations following us. And that's the heartache, that our children, your children, all of our children, our nation will suffer for.
You wonder why kids can't get a job? Because they can't read. Well, Sandra, you know, we could go on all day with this. There's a lot of things I'd like to talk to you about. I didn't give you a chance to say anything about the county commissioner. You're in your budget there, too.
We must be going crazy with two budgets. And, well, the county, I don't get as heartbroken over the county.
Uh-huh.
I tell people this, I came from poverty. So there were people who helped me all along the way. And because of it, I have a heart for children. I admit I'm a sucker for a kid. Because I feel that and they're vulnerable.
Right.
They cannot help themselves. They don't ask to be born into poverty. They don't ask to be born into alcoholism or drugs or all of the things that our society is plagued with. That thing that happened at Brentwood yesterday, that was a mental health issue.
That's right.
That man clearly had a mental health problem. And mental health, it's exploding in our nation. One of the guidance counselors who came to argue for her job, she argued by telling us the story of a young boy. He was middle school. He had come in and he told her that he was going to take the strings in his sweatshirt, you know how they can tie it at the neck. He was going to take those strings and wrap them around his throat and kill himself. And she said he was earnest. She said, I sat there looking at, and how can you not be brokenhearted for a kid that young who already wants to commit suicide?
Yeah.
So we're, and
that is a problem on the state. But Sandra, we have a problem, we're out of time.
Yeah.
And I'm going to have you back again after that June meeting so we can talk more about the budget.
I would love to.
And maybe we have something to talk about on the state level, seeing what happens with these educational legislation, seeing if anything changes.
Well, I would love to, now that we have identified the laws that take local control, that's what Attorney Bennett really did for us. I would love to see us, now that we've identified them, I hope we do something with it. I hope we change it. I hope that that whoever comes in the next wave, what's coming up here in June or the elections in November, right? So I hope that there will be people there who are willing to fight that battle.
Good. Well, thank you for your time. I know you're
thank
a fighter.
You. Yeah, too much.
Thank you again very much.
It was fun. Always a pleasure.
And listen to us again next time on The People's View.